called one of the greatest singer-songwriters in the history of rock. As the creative genius behind the seminal rock band Pink Floyd, he brought us masterpieces like Dark Side of the Moon and Wish You Were Here. In 1990, he staged one of the largest concerts of all time, the Wall Concert in Berlin. In recent years, he's turned his hands to opera, and he himself will name the pronunciation of the opera.
Well, the opera is called Saga.
Beautifully pronounced there. Roger Waters is here, and before we speak more than just those two words, here's a clip of him in action. Roger's here. Roger, was that whole experience of the Wall, would you say, one of the landmarks of your life, or the high point, or what?
That show back in 1990 was quite extraordinary. Yeah, I went with Leonard Cheshire. Asked me to do it back in the October of the previous year, and then, of course, famously on November the 9th. Of 89, yeah. The Wall came down, and we flew to Berlin and looked around. We were looking at the Maifeld, but then we looked round the corner at the Potsdamer Platz, which nobody had stepped on since 1945, and we went, wow, we have to do it here. And it was an extraordinary undertaking. So between November and the following June, we put the whole thing together and did the show.
Yeah. We went to Berlin at the time of the anniversary in November, and did President George Bush Senior and Gorbachev. But that concert had so many people. How many were there?
They don't know. They 260,000 paid, and then they just gave up. They just opened all the doors. So nobody really knows. Somewhere between 350 and 400,000 people, I think. It's a huge kind of sea of faces.
And you must have had a very good sound man.
We did, yeah. No, the sound was pretty good, and it was very moving looking out at them. And it was obviously a very big production, but it was also quite emotional because we had the mayor of East Berlin and the mayor of West Berlin, and Leonard Cheshire is a very inspirational figure.
Yes, and war hero and charity man and
exactly.
all of that. How did it all begin, really, Pink Floyd?
Pink Floyd.
Mm.
Well,
because it's 1990, that was when you were solo. Yeah.
I look rather sort of youthful and callow
I have to,
but that is 19 years ago.
So I think if you took your beard off, you'd look identical to you.
Well, Sid Barrett, Roger Barrett, and I were great pals in Cambridge when we were teenagers, and we were both knew we were going to go up to London to study something or other. I went up. To study architecture at the Regent Street Polytechnic. He came up a year later, or maybe 2 years later, and we'd always determined that we would be in a band together when we were both in London. He came to study art at Camberwell, painting, and he came up and moved into the apartment that I was already sharing with some other guys, and we already had a bit of a band going, and he joined, and one thing led to another, and two or three years later, after lots of birthday parties and hard slog, we turned pro.
As a group of people, so many of you first met so young and so on, makes the eventual split seem almost more bewildering. Or was it perhaps that you'd been together for so long that it had to happen?
Well, I think
How do you summarise it now?
Well, you know, it was a very long career, and I think we were a very, very close-knit team. With Sid, and then after Sid, after 1968, between 68 and 73, 74, when we produced Dark Side of the Moon, we were pretty close and we worked very closely together. And I think at that point, we'd sort of achieved at least one of the major ends, which was become very rich and very famous. And, you know, and sort of, you know, to be able to attract women and buy sports cars and those things that young men hanker after. And although we stayed together for a number of years after that, I think we really discovered at that point that we had different philosophies, both political and musical, and that it was inevitable that we would eventually, there would be some kind of schism and we would go our separate ways.
Yeah. And in fact, you hadn't played together for like 20-odd years when you played together for the Live 8 concert.
Yeah, which was fabulous. I'm so glad that we did that. Particularly in light of the fact that Rick, you know, died last year, and so we had that one small window of opportunity to actually play together for one last time, and it's very important to me that we did that. It was a terrific experience. I'm really, really happy we did it.
And what do you plan to do next? There are rumours you're going to do another tour.
I'm crunching all the numbers at the moment, and also with a view to taking The Wall, which is, you know, the other major kind of opus of my past career, out on the road, which I'll probably do later next year if everything works out. We're in the process of seeing if it can happen.
Good news.
Yeah, that'll be very exciting.
Absolutely. And if you were putting one thing in the time capsule for the world, for life,
yeah,
would it be The Wall, or would it be some, what else would it be?
No, you know, if I take The Wall out again on the road, which I'm really hoping to, I want it to be kind of pretty agitprop. I happen to have in my pocket, nothing to do with this, so I just put it in because I was reading an op-ed piece in the New York Times. And there's a great quote in here, it's by Bob Herbert, and it's talking about Afghanistan. And there's a great quote which he says, "I hate war," said Dwight Eisenhower, "as only a soldier who has lived it can, as one who has seen its brutality, its futility, its stupidity," end quote. But he also said, and this I didn't know, "Every gun that is made, every warship launched, every rocket fired, signifies in the final sense a theft from those who hunger and are not fed, those who are cold and are not clothed." Now, I don't know about you, but if you'd put those words into Dwight Eisenhower's mouth, I would have said, no, I don't believe that. But given all the speeches he made about being wary of the military-industrial complex.
It was surprising, wasn't it?
You know, we need to hang on to the words of the words of these wise people from our past. I'm actually far more focused on trying to sort out in my mind where the walls that we face now lie, whether there are media walls, or there are certainly economic walls and so on. And there are walls that are more subtle and insidious than the wall between North and South, the wall between rich and poor, the wall so on. We are the first generation to have had a real chance to get at some of the truth of what's going on, and in consequence possibly being able to sort out what to do about it. Now, successive generations, if they don't entirely waste their time, you know, playing video games, but use this stuff to these humane ends, have a chance, have a better chance than we, because it happened quite late on, you know, for us.
Yeah.
But it's all there now, and so people have the opportunity to sort out the truth from the lies, the wheat from the chaff, and so on.
Absolutely. Well, it's so good to have you with us. You're also, we haven't mentioned it, Hampshire's favourite fisherman, of course. That's another important part of your life, isn't it? Very important.
I love fly fishing.
It's great to have you with us.
David, thank you very much.
Thank you to... Bye.